Good evening, everybody. My name is Andy Serwer, and I am the editor-in-chief of Yahoo Finance, and I want to welcome all of you to this really exciting panel called Industry's Next Frontier. Before I introduce this great group, and it is a great group, and I know that because we had a great time in the green room together, I just want to, you know, say a quick word about the topic this evening, which is, you know, it's a part of our lives, and it's going to be a bigger part of all of our lives, I think, going forward. And it really concerns the circular economy, which to my mind means, instead of one-offs in terms of sustainability, having a holistic approach to understanding how your company, and in fact your life, is connected to the earth and to future generations. I mean, it's a big topic, but it is front and center right now. There are political implications, social implications, and of course economic implications. And just quickly, when I was doing some research on this panel, I saw this McKinsey report on it. And the line that sort of stuck with me is, the circular economy aims to eradicate waste, not just from manufacturing processes, as lean management aspires to do, but systematically through the life cycles and uses of products and their components. And it went on to talk about power drills being sold in China, and instead of all new power drills being sold, refurbished power drills could be sold at a discount to incentivize Chinese consumers to buy them. So let's get to our panel. And what's really cool about the panel, I think you'll see, is that it's incredibly diverse in many different ways. And so without further ado, Peter Agnefjall, I hope I did that at least somewhat okay.
Fairly well.
Oh, goodness.
Oh, very good.
Oh, thank you. Okay, see, he's nice to me. The CEO of IKEA, which is a great consumer brand, global consumer brand that all of us know very well. Next to Peter is Priv Bradoo, someone I've known for many, many years from Silicon Valley and Arkansas. Arkansas, we'll get to that in a second, very interesting. It's a company that's at the very center of these issues. Next to Priv and next to me is Devin Wenig, who is the CEO of eBay, another consumer company, but a digital consumer company that all of us know very, very well. And to my left, we're delighted to welcome Dr. Vincent Biruta, who is the Minister of Natural Resources from the Republic of Rwanda. And on his left is Jean-Pascal Tricoire, who is the CEO, and I probably didn't do that terribly
you
well.
You said that very well. It was really impressive.
This is the most polite panel in all of Davos to Americans. Thank you, merci, who is the CEO of Schneider Electric. So let's give them a welcoming hand. Dr. Biruta, I want to start with you and ask you, you know, Rwanda has actually been at the forefront of this sustainability trend in the world. You've taken a number of very interesting initiatives, and you recently signed a memorandum with the World Economic Forum. Can you talk about that a little bit, please?
Yes, yesterday we signed a memorandum of understanding, or a letter of intent, with the World Economic Forum. It is about the World Economic Forum to help us mainstreaming the circular economy into our policies, our strategies, and make sure that the circular economy principles are brought into the DNA of our production and consumption systems. We aim at building an African alliance on a circular economy, and we work with World Economic Forum to do all this and to make sure you have a network of countries which are implementing the circular economy principles.
Awesome. Peter, IKEA is known for being, and I mean this in the best possible way, kind of a quirky company, meaning you guys think differently. And I think a lot of us as customers of your company really celebrate that. And I think that's been one of the great appeals of your company. How is the circular economy connected to what IKEA does? Is it at its core?
I'd say like this, that as you say, quite a few of the customers know our blue and yellow boxes, our stores, but maybe they know less about what's happening behind the scenes. We're working on a quite ambitious growth strategy, which is to grow IKEA together. And while doing so, we have also some 5-6 years ago, once and for all, decided that we would like to do so within the limits of the planet. And actually, we would like to grow and double IKEA in size, but we don't want to do it in a way that we are becoming less bad only towards the environment. We actually would like to have a positive impact on people and the planet. The way we do so is that basically we're working according to three areas. The first one is that we try to stimulate our customers to live a more sustainable life at home. We try to make our own operations sustainable, and we try to have a positive impact on people on the communities where we operate. And when it comes to circularity, I think this is one of the newer things that we are starting to work upon. How can we improve the circularity of our offering and of IKEA and the way we do business? And we've taken steps forwards, but we're still young. We're still in the beginning. There are many more things to do. But in 10 days from now, we will introduce our first kitchen front, which is made out of recycled wood fiber. And it's covered with plastic coming from recycled PET bottles. So step by step, we're taking steps into also becoming a more circular IKEA.
Devin, I'll be honest with you. You know I'm always honest with you, right?
Not always.
Oh. See, they beat up on the media. They just keep beating up on the media.
We'll go with always.
Okay, thank you. When I first saw that you guys, when you were on this panel, I was wondering what was eBay doing, you know, in a circular economy panel? Because you think about e-commerce, it has nothing to do. You just go online and buy stuff. And what does that really have to do with a circular economy? But once I looked into it, there's definitely some connectivity there, right?
I think there's two things that are incredibly important. The impact of technology, and in particular technology platforms, is a major theme here at Davos. It's obviously one of the most impactful forces that's impacting billions of lives around the planet. The way I look at it is eBay has two roles, and I won't speak for Silicon Valley, but I know that ethos runs deep in the technology industry. One is our own company driving us to sustainability. It's really important that corporations have a conscience and that they understand that their actions have implications on generations forward. So you see a lot of announcements, including from us, about things like sustainable data centers and moving to zero carbon footprint in their power consumption and supply. This is really important because the fastest growing sector of the economy is things like data centers and technology.
Right.
But the unique thing about not just eBay, but the sharing economy and platform companies, and in some ways, I'm proud to think of eBay as a pioneer in the sharing economy 21 years ago, is that it's a force magnifier when your platform promotes consumer sustainability. And if you think about, although it's a minority of our business, the resale of goods, if you think about the role of car sharing services or home sharing services, they are plays on capacity. They are about matching supply and demand. They are about eliminating excess capacity from the economy. That has a massive impact on sustainability, frankly, much greater than individual companies going carbon neutral. So for us, we look at our business as we have an internal role, but arguably a much more important external role to drive overcapacity out of the system, and that has an incredibly powerful impact on sustainability.
Yeah, you think about things that people put up for sale at eBay, and in some instances, they would be throwing those things out into landfill, but there's value there, as evidenced by the fact that people pay for the stuff, and then they use it themselves. Someone else needs
billions
it.
Of dollars of value, right. And it's not only the landfill impact, it's also the item that doesn't need to be remade,
right.
Because
right.
Somebody is fine with last generation's iPhone and doesn't need a brand new one to be stamped out. Both of those are important.
Yeah, that's how you fit. Jean-Pascal, maybe you can talk a little bit about, let me ask you sort of the same table setting question about Schneider and how you fit into the circular economy sort of in a big picture way. And people might be a little bit less familiar with your company because it's not so much as a consumer brand as some of these guys over here.
Yeah, of course. Yeah. Well, we sometimes you don't know us, but we are in your life at every moment. What we do are efficiency on energy connected solutions to power your home, your building, the manufacturing where you work, on the infrastructure where you travel. And when you look at the world of energy, it's a world full of challenges because on one side, we need to bring energy to today 1.3 billion people who don't have access to electricity, on the next 2 billion that will join us in the next coming 30 years. And at the same time, we know we face a climate change challenge. where energy is the first of the way we produce and we consume energy today is the main contributor. Therefore, we need to solve all of this, to increase the efficiency of everything we do in the field of energy by a factor of three. So what we do is that we apply technology, we connect everything to the internet, and we save and we share better the energy. So what we do is that we connect your home, we connect the buildings, we connect the manufacturing, we connect that to big data so that you can apply more computing and get more services. You were challenging me, you were asking me about a news last week where we acquired a company that's going to collect the data that we have assembled of what you do and make sure that against your profile of consumption, we're going to source renewable energy to make sure that your consumption will become completely or fully based on renewable. On manufacturing, to speak about circular economy, manufacturing is a big application for us. We automate production lines for our customers. And of course, what we want is to reduce the waste and make sure that we isolate the waste and organize the recycling into the production lines. So that's what we do.
Great. With all due respect to the other panelists, I save the best for last, Priv. And you know, Priv is an actual practitioner of the circular economy. So in other words, these guys are participants, but she actually is kind of a cog and makes it work. That's what she does. That's the core, the very core of what she does. And maybe you guys aren't familiar with BlueOak, but it's a really cool company. So Priv, I'd really like you to talk to us about what you guys do.
Sure. So actually, let me lay a little bit of the background. So, you know, we're here talking about the fourth industrial revolution, talking about exponential technologies, accelerating pace of accelerating technologies. And yet, you know, I'm not sure there's as much reflection about what happens, what's the dark side of this accelerating force on the in the world of technology. And so 6 years ago, we founded BlueOak with the mission of making the technology sector more sustainable. And the way we do that is sort of stepping back and looking at what goes into powering technologies. Obviously, it's the world of electrons. That's the thing that we think of most often. But it's also the world of atoms and molecules. And some of the most valuable parts of electronics are metals such as copper, gold, silver, palladium. About 10% of the world's gold supply, give or take, goes into electronics. About 30% of the world's silver supply goes into electronics. And if you actually take, let's say, a ton of cell phones, you can actually extract the same amount of gold as 100 tons of gold ore.
And
as
I say it again, so how many cell phones for 100 tons?
So a ton of cell phones will give you the same amount of gold as 100 tons of gold ore.
Mm. I'm going to start a recycling business. No, go ahead. I like that. That's cool.
But as you sort of think about that on one hand, you actually look at the other side and you look at how, you know, dirty gold, for example, is becoming the cause célèbre in the mining world. And as you look at sort of the consumers of the future generations or our current generation, I think they're very value-based customers and they really care about sort of the values of the companies that they're purchasing from. So we're trying to sort of bridge the gap between the technology and luxury goods sectors and the atoms and molecules that power those technologies and make that entire cycle more sustainable.
So you take electronic components, parts, computers, laptops, phones, and do what with them specifically?
So we take the electronic scrap. We essentially take it through a proprietary furnace that we have, and we extract the metal value out of it while sustainably dealing with all of the other elements, the plastics, the refractories. So it's a complete closed loop cycle that we operate. And then we sell the high value metals into the luxury goods sectors and the technology sector is really interested in purchasing.
How many different types of elements and metals or what are some, you said gold, what else do you get out of this stuff?
So we get copper. So in terms of the valuable metals, you've got copper, gold, silver, palladium. But you actually have about 60 elements, or give or take again, that are comprised within electronic scrap. You know, would we like to focus on recoveries and many more? So there's tin, there's iron, there's nickel, there's aluminum. There's just a number of different elements. How well You can focus on any one of those. It's obviously dependent on the pricing on any given element, and that sort of goes into sort of how markets evolve to embracing circular economies.
All right. This is being streamed globally on Yahoo Finance right now, this session. And it's a little after noon in North America, in the United States. And in about 23 hours plus, Donald Trump will be sworn in as the new president of the United States. And Devin, your company recently signed a letter to President Trump regarding climate change. And I'm wondering if you can talk a little bit about why you guys did that. There are a lot of companies, I think several, 100 or so, that did. But can you talk to us about your thinking there?
I think it's about transparency and commitment. Words matter, but action matters a lot more. And particularly for Silicon Valley, this was a letter a lot of tech companies signed on to. Not to repeat myself, but this is the fastest growing sector of the economy. Software is swallowing the world. And with that comes responsibility. With that comes a responsibility to understand the implications of those actions. Here in Davos, we've been talking a bit about the responsibility that we ensure that the technology revolution doesn't net eliminate jobs or create more income inequality. Equally, sustainability and a planet that we can give to our children and our children's children is a huge obligation on all of us. So without getting into the detail of the letter, it is an obligation to drive our companies and our industry to take climate change seriously, to move to zero carbon footprints. And we're happy to do that along with a number of our big technology peers.
Great. Dr. Biruta, excuse me, I wanted to ask you about some of the specific initiatives that President Kagame has undertaken. One that was interesting to me was banning plastic bags. And, plastic bags are used by almost everybody all over the world. I've been in countries, though, in Africa, where you see plastic bags just all over the place. And at the very least, it's an eyesore. At the very worst, it's toxic for humans, animals, plants, but there's an economic cost. Can you talk a little bit about how your government made that decision?
Yes, so my government took that decision for the reason you have mentioned: litter, pollution of water bodies, pollution of soil, and many other problems related to polythene plastic bags. That decision was taken. It has created challenges in terms of packaging, but it has created opportunities because you have seen recycling industries being established. Today we have 5 plastic recycling plants, and that has brought jobs opportunities. And we have also seen people investing in alternative packaging solutions, which are eco-friendly. So I think what we have gained in banning plastics is much bigger than the challenges we have and we're still facing.
So when you guys did this, obviously, the plastic bag companies objected. Did the ordinary citizens get upset about this as well?
Ordinary citizens don't have any problem. Those who have problems are people in industries. Mm-hmm. So those one have been complaining, but with time, everybody understand that we gained more by banning plastic rather than keeping it, because it has created opportunities, and we're still looking for solutions for our industries for packaging, and that creates new opportunities
right.
in the business sector.
And so these sustainable packaging companies, that's an opportunity for them to grow and
yes.
to, recycle renewable fibers and things like that
yes.
to make that kind of thing.
Yeah.
Can I just
sure, please.
On what the minister said? I think we often tend to take sort of a very West-centric view of the world about technology pioneering, the circular economy. And I think sometimes there's wisdom in stepping back and looking at many places in the world which actually thrive on circular economies. A country that I have little context about is India. And you look at places like India, and there is no concept of waste, right? You utilize every asset as much as you possibly can, because that's actually more efficient and derives more value. Again, if you look at sort of the automotive industry, and this is sort of around the world, you know, they've got some of the highest recycling rates, you know, and that's something to learn from. So I just think that, you know, while their technologies enable us to achieve the values that that our generation represents, I think there's a lot of wisdom from many places and many business models that have come before us. To just that humility, I think, is really important.
I like that idea of different nations having different really values almost when it comes to this in history. Sweden, you know, has a different take as well, right?
Yeah, for sure. Sweden is one of the countries that quite early introduced a CO2 tax in order to encourage customers to go for renewables, to go for wind, solar, and to encourage the transformation of the society. And I think we at IKEA, we've of course been inspired about those kind of initiatives that have been taken. We have decided that by 2020 we will produce the same amount of renewable by our own renewable sources, predominantly wind and solar, as we consume totally as a group. We've invested now in 341 wind turbines, and it's actually so, for the first moment in time, we have as many wind turbines as we have stores, which is quite funny. So behind the scenes, the IKEA group has also turned into be, you could say, a small renewable energy company, but we produced 3.2 terawatt hours last year of our own sustainable wind, due to that we get inspirations from countries, from other companies, and through our own initiatives.
If I may add to that, it's our business, right, to provide technologies to save energy and to organize this this circular economy. But we really are applying that to ourselves. And it's striking that you can always progress. You can always find something to do different and to do cheaper. So every 3 years, we reduce our energy consumption by 10%. And you always say it's going to be very, very difficult for the next cycle. But actually, you
how many,
always
I'm sorry,
find,
let me interrupt. How many years do you say? Every year?
Every 3 years.
Every
over
3 years.
The past 10 years. So you grind and you measure. You identify on the data enables you to be more and more specific and more precise on what you do. Mm-hmm. And we voted ourselves also to be carbon neutral in the next 5 years. Mm-hmm. And that's really by saving and at the same time offsetting and sourcing better and producing better the energy. And you would say, okay, it's all for communication. If you are very cynical, just for your P&L, I mean, the things that we as industrialists don't like is to be submitted to risks. And we live in a world where the oil price 3 years ago was $100 plus dollars. 2 years after, it was $30 plus dollars. Now it's $50. And people hate that, to be submitted. We hate that, right?
Yeah.
On the top of it, it makes our products better. We operate, we do 50% of our business in the emerging world. I live in China today. I live most of my career in emerging countries. So the motivation that you find country by country can be very different. In India, for instance, you have to operate sometimes within scarcity. You don't have energy all the time. So you have to operate your operations when there is no power grid, when there is a default of supply. In China, and I live in one of those cities, you want to reduce the pollution on the particles, and that's a very strong motivation to do things better. So at the end of the day, would it be for the economics? Would it be for the air quality? Would it be because you have no choice because the supply is not yet there? There is a very strong motivation to get these carbon neutrality, those savings, on those savings. The other thing I would like to mention then is that it has been a strong incentive to innovation because constraint is really the mother of a lot of innovation. When you have no choice, suddenly you imagine new things that you had not thought about before. And today, for instance, we've developed technologies in India that we're exporting everywhere, including in the mature world, to store energy and to shave the peaks and to supply energy in an autonomous manner. So I think it's more than a fashion or responding to KPIs. And it's really a major trend for innovation.
I think in reality, what we see is that you know, if we start with the customer, in our case, the many people living around the planet in one of the countries where we operate. We see if we do things that are really good for them, the vision of ours is to create a better everyday life for the many people. If we do something that's good for them, then in the second step, we need to figure out how can we make that good for IKEA too. And if you do it that way, it's a lot easier to end up on the right side of the equation than if you think the other way around. We have one example that I just love, and that is a couple of years ago, we decided to ban selling traditional incandescent bulbs. And they've been on the market since the 18th century, more or less. And it's not a very efficient way to produce light. And now we have LED technology, the most efficient way to produce light. We converted our total lighting range, took out all the incandescent bulb, replaced them with LEDs. By doing so, we were able to direct the volumes to our suppliers because customers still would like to have some light. Our colleagues in the supply chain could convert the value chain, and we could invest, optimize production. The LED bulb that costed 12 euros is now soon down to 1, so we've been able to shave off 90% of the cost for the customers. And the beauty of the equation is that it's really good for the environment too.
Right.
It consumes 85% less energy, meaning more money in the wallet for the customer, but it also means 85% less carbon emissions. So at the end of the day, good for the customer, good for the planet, and you know what? Good for IKEA too.
I will actually just come back and tie it back to Andy, the point that you raised about, you know, the time it is in the United States of America, and a large theme that sort of being talked about is job creation and meaningful employment. And one of the incredible things about the circular economy is that it's actually a distributed business model, right? These are regional, local, as opposed to necessarily, you know, the traditional global model. When you look at the sharing economy, it allows a number of people to participate within that that region or that city or that town. When I look at a business like mine, we're really proud to be based in Arkansas, where we've got people with great work ethic, but, you know, we're also really eager to reskill and retrain. Mm. And so I think just the beauty of sort of the cost imperatives that it allows us to achieve, the customer driven values that you can satisfy, but also just the by nature they're distributed regional and promote that kind of reskilling, retraining, and job creation.
Yeah, I think it's really fascinating because we talk about the disruption of technology, and when it comes to employment, that's actually a code phrase for loss of jobs. I mean, that's what, you know, technology does, quite frankly, in one regard to employment. And that's so interesting that the circular economy can be seen as a job creator that way, and a distributed job creator, to your point. It's interesting also, Priv, that you mentioned employees, because we've talked a lot about customers, as we well should, but I want to talk about some other constituencies that all of you have to deal with, which are employees and, in some instances, shareholders. And so, Devin, I want to ask you about the dialogue between your employees and the dialogue between shareholders when it comes to a circular economy. What do they tell you? What do you tell them? And does it move the needle in terms of your relationship?
I think it's an easier conversation for us because, as we said before, it is our business. And, you know, it's very heartening to hear the story from Schneider and from IKEA, because I think that when corporations or CEOs give rhetoric to issues, but they're incented on an entirely different set of things, their employees know that. They people cut through that fairly quickly. And at the end of the day, let's not kid ourselves, these are corporations and our main job is to create value for our owners. But that doesn't mean there's not a social mission. And if that social mission is linked to business, like you just heard here and like I said before, core to eBay is driving that reuse economy, driving that circular economy that in some ways, at least digitally, we invented. Mm-hmm. When that happens, our shareholders are happy. Mm-hmm. When we grow our reuse business, we make money. That's our business. So you try to link the mission of the company and the responsibility to the world with the profit incentive. And that's when you really get things moving.
I want to ask Jean-Pascal the same question, but Peter, I'm going to ask you, come on. You got rid of light bulbs, incandescent light bulbs, but you're a private company where your company owned by a foundation. Do you think it's easier?
I think
to do these kinds of things?
Yes and no. Of course, the advantage is that we don't really need to think short term. We can act in a much more longer term. We can strategize and we can invest in a way that we don't have the kind of the quarterly axe hunting us. But of course, on the other end, the only source of capital that we have is the money that we generate ourselves. So in a way, we have to make
more disciplined, maybe.
It means that we have to make the money before we we invest them, right? So there are pros and cons, I think, with all ownership models. Ours is certainly proven to be successful over time so far. I think it will be so in the future, too.
Jean-Pascal, I do want to ask you about the same question that I asked Devin in terms of the constituencies, your employees and your shareholders. The dialogue was saying we're doing these things like reducing energy costs. Does it move the needle? I thought that was fascinating when you made that point about oil prices. Who in their right mind would want to be beholden to an input that goes from 150 to 30 to 53? I mean, right? You'd want to do everything you could to get away from that.
I agree with that.
There you go. That was your point. But shareholders and...
Yeah, well, I like very much this question. So we quantify everything we do in sustainable development. And we have invented a barometer in which we've put the different constituencies of it. And the whole companies work into it. So and we publicize this with our quarterlies. So it's as important as the financials. And executives and everybody in the company has a financial incentive, which is balancing the economics, linked to our progress in sustainable development. So it has really become a force of mobilization in the company. Do I believe that this drives the behavior of the people, those financials? I don't think so. I think people are just motivated to make the company better on better impacting the society. But it brings a logic. It brings a structure. We are all looking at the same direction on the same indicators. And we publicize it to the shareholders. So then you've got this funny discussion where shareholders tell you, well, of course, we're interested by the economics, but the company has a different mission, which is more complete. So you should balance the economics with other indicators. And the next day, they tell you, yeah, but your incentive was too high respect to your economics, because, in fact, your sustainable development. So I think it's really a dialogue that we have more and more. I just regret one thing, is that I don't think there is enough weighing on this aspect in the choice or in the dialogue with investors. Because at the end of the day, sustainable development means that the company you are investing in is much less risky. It's serving the right thing. So as an investor, and especially long-term investors, this dimension of preparation of the future on being in line with the interests of the planet, on the society, on the communities, of the people who work with you is extremely important. So we've pushed that to an extreme publicity, on an extreme consistency across the company.
I think that's great, that notion that you're master of your own destiny much more if you are a circular company or in the circular economy. And that's real. By the way, you said you wish, your only regret is there are more weight on the sustainability part, right? But if you're the chief executive...
No, we do it just in a dialogue that we have with our investors, which is a great dialogue, which is they know us very well. We meet, we've been meeting for now more than 10 years every quarter. So, but I think this has to develop even more.
I think also to build on that, so far the demands on disclosure from governments, from investors, from institutions has been quite limited. But obviously this is going to be an area that's going to increase substantially. Possibly it will also be a demand, a legislation, where you're required as a company to do so. And of course, if you're then pioneering and driving these questions at an early stage by your own belief, eventually the companies are going to be in a situation that they will create more shareholder value at the end.
So I would say the trend for big public companies is there are increasingly large institutional investors are asking for social and environmental impact.
Yeah.
And it was on the fringe 5 years ago. I wouldn't call it the majority, but there's very few shareholder meetings you go to now, at least large institutions, where it does not come up in the conversation.
I think that's spot on. I mean, because it used to be sort of the NGOs that would rattle the cage and say, oh, you can't, you know, be so linked to fossil fuels. But now, to your point, Jean-Pascal, that it's coupled with risk, right? And so to free yourself just, for instance, from oil and other sort of practices, it is a better ROI, right?
I think so. And I also think that many investors also recognize their role in sustainability of the planet. Part of it is we're all in this together and we have to fix it together. If the chain of ownership and corporations and customers is not aligned, you get friction.
Right, right.
You know, what I will say, Andy, is that, you know, I think as a young startup, what I really care about is this moving away from being investor and shareholder driven and really thinking about it as being customer and stakeholder driven.
Yeah.
And so when you look at sort of companies like Method Soap as an example, which just comes to mind, you know, people buy that brand. I buy that brand. People will pay a premium on that brand because of the values that it represents and because they relate to those values. Now, obviously, it's a little bit harder when you're B2B. But I do think there's something, you know, when we look at precious metals and when we work with partners in the luxury goods space, it is because they recognize that their customers care more and more about the values behind what they're buying. So I think in some way, if you can tie it back to the customer, the shareholder will follow.
You know, it's interesting because this rise of the circular economy is simultaneous with the decline of the orthodoxy of shareholder return above all. I mean, that was because it used to be, to your point, Priv, CEOs would say that's the only job I have is to maximize shareholder value.
I guess what I'm saying is you can maximize shareholder value through sort of this being at the center of creating value for your company. The one counter I would sort of add is, you know, in some of these debates about globalization, you know, and what that means, when you look at companies particularly that are producing things,
right.
One thing that becomes hard when you look at sort of competitiveness of prices within your ecosystem versus outside, I think it's pricing externalities. So one of the things that we hear in the electronics industry, for example, is that it doesn't affect us directly because we're sort of a downstream player, but midstream players, one of the things that they struggle with is they say, you know, it's hard to compete with processing prices here when you've got countries around the world that are willing to import this for free and the questionable practices that are employed in terms of, you know, recovering value within those countries. So it's hard to compete sometimes within certain industries when you've got externalities that aren't priced in. And so it's almost like, you know, tying this to this theme of globalization, I think you need to be on an even playing field in order to be competitive in some way.
Right.
A few elements on the top of, if you're able to operate the same process with half of the resources, you're going to be more competitive than your competitor, especially when you go into new economies where resources are more scarce. Second point, I think the problem that we all have is to attract the best talents because the company is not better than the sum of the collective game of its people. And people like the problem of this time is a lack of sense sometimes, the lack of why do I do all that job? And giving that sense of working for the planet and community regives another kind of sense and direction to the work you do. And the third point is that very often technology is associated to job cuts. If I look at energy, today we are putting figures around that, but renewable employs five times more people than the old world of energy for a kilowatt hour produce. Mm. So and just because one thing is that you replace consumption of resources by the deployment of people that will maintain and organize energy on the ground.
I do want to get back to you about China, by the way, Jean-Pascal. And I also want to put out there that we will be doing a Q&A in a few minutes, so get your questions ready. I'm sure you have a bunch. And I also don't want to neglect Dr. Biruta and talk to you a little bit about the role of government here because, you know, it's all about public-private partnership ultimately. And, you know, getting back to some of the initiatives you did, I was reading here about your Kigali Green City Initiative. Yes. And the Fonerwa Green Fund. So my question is, how do you actually go about implementing these initiatives, and how do you work with the private sector to make this stuff actually happen?
So the role of every government is to put in place policies, laws, and regulations, and the right strategies in place. So in Rwanda, we adopted our green growth and climate resilience strategy in 2011, and we established our green fund for Nirwa as the arm to implement and to fund, to finance these, the implementation of that strategy. And our green fund is working with the private sector. It is funding private sector, the private people who are bringing in, project proposals. And we cannot do anything without the private sector anyway. Even at the policy making level, we need to consult all the stakeholders, including the private sector. So the private sector is at all the stages. We are taking in adopting policies and putting in place the strategies and implementing them.
How would you describe your relationship with the private sector in your country, the government's relationship?
We have a very good relationship with the private sector. As an example, like now we are preparing for the next fiscal year. Mm-hmm. When we prepare the budget, we need to consult the private sector. Mm. We need to have meetings, and every sector has to meet with the private sector, which is involved
really
in that particular sector. We consult them, we talk to them about the fiscal measures which are likely to be taken with a new fiscal year. And we have their input and we take them into consideration, and we can move together when we start implementation.
Wow.
I think we see an enormous development in the interaction between businesses and governments today. If I just relate back 5 years, it was, to me, I think my impression was very much that governments were a little bit concerned about raising demands to businesses, and that businesses would be against it. I think with Paris, things changed. Businesses raised their voice. They said clearly that we want an agreement, we stand behind you, and we will do our part to implement it. So the interaction between businesses and governments today are, I would say, radically different than it were a couple of years ago.
But of course, varies wildly country by country, right?
Sure, yes, of course. It varies from country to country, but still the overall movement and the trend is clearly the same across the globe.
Let me stick with you, Peter, and ask you. I kind of played a, it's just put these guys to the test, I guess is the way to put it. I did a search, a news search for these companies to see if there were any recent news stories about them that pertained to the circular economy and sustainability. And I have to say, there were, so these companies were walking the talk. So that's nice to hear. For you, Peter, I thought this was really interesting. Swedish furniture giant IKEA announced Monday, that would be this Monday, that they finished installing solar panels at their new Renton, Washington, the state of Washington in the US location, creating the largest rooftop solar installation anywhere in the state. And I looked at this, it is massive. I don't know how many square feet it is, but and there are, you know, other big stores like Costco, which is headquartered in Washington State as well. So is this something you're doing around the globe?
Well, it is. As I said earlier, we have committed ourselves by 2020, we will produce the same amount of energy as the group is consuming. We have invested in 730,000 PV installations that we predominantly put on our rooftops. And we have soon the same amount of windmills as we have stores. And it would probably be even more going forward. So for sure it is, and I think there's a continuation of that story, because the fact that we are now a big purchaser of PV solar panels, what we have started with now is also to start offering them to our customers. We started off 2 years ago in the UK, we moved on to Switzerland, we kicked it off again in the Netherlands last week, so now a customer can enter one of our stores to buy towels or a new bookcase, but I can also come home with a rooftop installation of a complete sustainable PV installation that will be installed to their homes. So it's a lovely thing that we do, and I'm really proud of it. But again, there's more to do for us in activate and stimulate customers to live a more sustainable life at home.
And the other news story, by the way, for IKEA in the past week, did you want to make a point? Go ahead, I'm sorry.
Yes, I wanted to give an example of how our Green Fund is working with the private sector and the relationship with, between the government and the private sector. Our Green Fund has supported the establishment of a new waste plant, which is going to be inaugurated next month. And it has given around $1 million. Mm. But that plant will not be operated by the government. It will be operated by a private company. And thus, we resolve our problem to deal with e-waste. At the same time, the private sector is going to be involved and the private company is going to do business. And in doing so, we solve the problem of the e-waste and we create jobs and the private sector will be part of that journey.
And where is this again, I'm sorry?
We are inaugurating the plant next month.
Mm-hmm. Okay. It sounds like a model. That's great. Any questions out there from the audience at this point? We've got one right up here in the front row.
Hi, I'm a global shaper, Daisy Guo from Shanghai Hub. I'm a very big fan of IKEA. You know, the booming growth of platforms in China, they have furniture platforms. They now open their offline shops to curate the loop of consuming experience of lifestyle. And I really love IKEA. I want to know that what's your strategy to maintain your competitiveness in China?
I think it's a good question. We've been in China for many years. We started our retail operation there in the end of the 90s. We have grown and developed over the years. We today have 21 stores, and adjacent to that, we have three of our own shopping centers. So to continue to grow and develop our business in China is, of course, essential. And we do so by a number of initiatives. We try to continue to work in an efficient way to get cost out of our setup that doesn't contribute to customer value. We try to make IKEA more accessible by introducing e-commerce. We have just started off in Shanghai, and later on we will start doing that in total China. But of course we will also continue to build pickup points for customers ordering their products online or through our store, and building more stores. We still only have 21 stores in China. And if you compare, in Sweden we have 20 stores. On tomorrow we're 10 million people living in Sweden, and 20 stores, so basically 2 stores per million inhabitants. And in China we have 21 stores on 1 point something billion inhabitants. So of course we're still just very small. We're just at the beginning, and we have so much more to do to really to create a better everyday life for the many people in China.
And people like to go to IKEAs in China to relax, right? Yeah. You know those stories, you know, right?
I'm happy that Shanghai
has right. Good. And speaking of China, before we get to another question, JP, you said you live there now?
Yeah, well, Asia-Pac has become our biggest mm-hmm. region. So I transferred to Hong Kong, actually, mm-hmm. 6 years ago. And we manage all company with a team which is scattered around the world, part in the Americas and a part in Europe. But I reside with a part of my team in China. Yeah. Yeah.
So is it harder or easier? How is the challenge to be a circular company different in China?
We've got many Chinese friends here that would be in a better position to...
But for you, from your experience, I mean, running Schneider...
From our experience, I mean, things are not fundamentally different. I mean, China is just huge, and the speed of development has been much faster than in any other country. So the challenges that you are facing, and we are facing, we employ 26,000 people in China, and more than 20,000 in India. So I'm just saying that the problems are the same. They are just 20 times bigger. That's all.
Right. Other questions? I have one right here, a couple over on the side.
So a really great session. One question that I have is, when you have strategy from the top about circular economy, how do you make it down? Like, how do you make the message down and make sure, especially for like all of the companies are global, like IKEA having thousands of stores, how do you make sure every single place that gets...
Do you want to talk about that?
duplicated?
Well, like with most things, it's not what you expect, it's what you inspect. And it's about setting goals and targets and having people really clear. To my point before, it's a lot easier when your business goals and your circular economy or your social goals are aligned. Giving a speech and saying we want to do something and then setting goals that are antithetical to that is inauthentic, and it inevitably leads to no progress. So for us, it's a percentage of our reuse business. It's a percent of data center sustainability. Those are very clear goals that people in our company are paid on.
I think from our sake, of course, as managers and leaders, you kind of lead by example. And what you say, what you do, what you talk about, normally the organization tends to talk about too. But at IKEA, we are a company with clear values and with a clear IKEA culture. And we're really not a top-down company. So a lot of the force and the driving force and the initiative actually comes from our many coworkers, having one idea of how they can do something a little bit better than they did yesterday. For instance, how can we store, save, recycle some of the packaging material that's coming around our pallets once the goods are being delivered into our stores? And they start to think about it, we start to work together with it, and then suddenly we realize that we can recycle it and actually turn into a new IKEA product. For instance, the new tomato spray bottle that's now entirely made out of a recycled IKEA wrapping plastic. So working together, not being top down, but of course the leaders have a role to play in leading the company.
Do you want to comment? You have thousands of people.
It's a very good question because it's actually quite complex. The first thing is that you have to map what you are doing end to end. If I take our example, 70% of what we sell is produced by partner suppliers. So when we speak about our carbon footprint or when we speak about recyclability, you have to take an end-to-end view of the whole cycle. So when we go to carbon footprint, we go back to the mine of copper that enter in our products later. The second thing which I join you is really empower people. Mm. Once you have mapped the issue and you've set KPIs that everybody is working roughly in the same direction, leave the people on the site, in a plant, in an office, propose solutions on working it together. And the third thing is really celebrate success and share, replicate, cookie paste what's working. On the non-invented years, probably the biggest barrier to progress today, because there are plenty of solutions. Technologies are here. It's just the speed of adoption, which is a problem. We are the problem.
Before I get to the next question, I just want to ask you, Priv, just quickly. So how did you get to Arkansas? And for those of you who are not familiar with the United States geography, it's a fairly remote place.
Actually, we ran a competitive process. We had partners, owners, shareholders who helped us with sort of competitively mapping various states in the U.S. And Arkansas actually came out really on the top in terms of the key metrics that go into sort of our cost structure, which are electricity, so it's a really low power cost. Ease of doing business, I mean, just fantastic sort of support from the Arkansas Department of Environmental Quality. Skilled labor, I mean, they're all sort of trained for the kind of work that we're doing. Our largest investor is the Pension Fund of Arkansas, an incredibly forward-looking investor has been a huge supporter of everything that we're doing. And the entire ecosystem within Arkansas is actually really committed to making Osceola, Arkansas, the recycling capital of the world. And not just because of what we're doing, we also have a $1.5 billion steel mill right next to us with a similar shareholder structure. So.
And it's creating jobs in the part of America that our new president is keen on. So, but you were doing that way before, right?
Yeah, we started.
Good question.
Hello, this is Sohara. I'm a global shaper from Bangladesh. So I think that overall there is the understanding that the moral imperative is perhaps not good enough for businesses to go green, and there has to be a business case of some sort for them to transition. I was wondering if you could share what would be some of the good measures that governments around the world could take to promote such kind of a transition to more sustainable practices for businesses. Thank you.
You'll ask both the private sector and the public sector that question, right? Anyone want to take that?
I think today, I would really encourage governments to be clear to companies that they need to disclose their environmental impact. I think that could actually help us quite a lot. Many companies are doing quite a lot of things, but are quite a few that doesn't. So by actually disclosing the environmental impact of their business, I think we could actually stimulate a bigger movement than we do today. The business cases are there. The investments we are doing makes a lot of sense from a financial perspective. So I think it's just that we need to have more of a level playing field in that area.
Private, sorry, we'll go to the public.
As I stated earlier, the role of a government is to put in place the policies, the strategies, and the regulations. And in doing so, starting from now, if you adopt the circular economy principles, you need to put them in the policies, in the strategies, and to put in place the regulation which is needed to have those principles implemented. And of course, on the other side, maybe the government will need to put in place incentives to make sure everybody adopts the new principles based on the policies, but also based on the incentives which are in place. I can give you an example.
Please.
We use, when we approve a new project, we use to ask for environmental impact assessment. And in doing so, if we adopt the circular economy principles, we can take that into consideration in that particular report or ask, put in place new requirements to be fulfilled by any new investor for a new project. And from that, you can move forward.
Well, we are just about out of time here, and I hope you guys all enjoyed this panel as much as I did. Just to summarize a few points, I think that, you know, the circular economy ultimately should not only be even or as good as a traditional company, but even better, ultimately, in terms of all kinds of KPIs, even ones that shareholders like. Right? I think that working with governments, public-private partnerships is absolutely essential. And then finally, I think inclusiveness with all constituencies is incredibly important. So I think those are some really good takeaways. And, you know, I think it's great to emulate these leaders up here on the stage. And if you guys can take that back with you and your companies and your countries and your NGOs, whoever you represent, I think that this could really do a lot of great stuff for the world. So please join me in thanking this great panel.